want a serious crisis to go to waste.
If I could have gotten 51 votes in the Senate of the United States for an outright ban, picking up every one of them, Mr. and Mrs. America, turn them all in, I would have done it.
I have two words for you. Predator drones. You will never see it coming.
It's time for On Target Radio, Chicagoland's only radio show dedicated to the red meat issues that affect your life. From gun control to freedom of speech. Now, debating, debunking, and discussing today's hot issues, here are your hosts, David Lombardo and Gretchen Fritz.
Welcome to On Target Radio. Tonight, David and Gretchen's guest is Amy Dillon, a former Marine Corps drill instructor and combat marksmanship instructor. A South Carolina resident, Dillon is an active firearms instructor, author, competitive shooter, and Second Amendment advocate. And be sure to stick around for tonight's Segment 6, when Dillon will be talking about a new company specializing in women's concealed carry. So be sure to give us a call at 312-642-5600, or go to Facebook and like our page, On Target Radio, and ask a question there.
And now, from the seething cauldron of personal opinion, it's time for David's Rant of the Week.
There are a couple of hard truths that the shooting community must face. And this is not an indictment of those denizens of the Second Amendment community, but rather a reaffirmation of understanding. I doubt few would disagree that, for the most part, the shooting sports have historically been populated by white, middle and upper class males. That isn't to discount the fact that there have been more than a few women and persons of color, but a hard longitudinal look at the world of guns is clearly pasty white with facial hair. It's not my intention to obviate the efforts of many organizations over the years to make the shooting world accessible to what I've long called non-traditional shooters, meaning women, youth, minorities, and the disabled. However, it is my intention to point out current research conducted by the Pew Research Center suggests that only about 11.7% of legal gun owners are women, blacks, and Asians, each account for 15%, and 11% are Hispanic. Similar statistics for disabled Americans are apparently non-existent. However, Disabled Americans for Firearm Rights, a group formed before the 2012 Newtown, Connecticut school shooting, quadrupled its membership to 19,000 after that event. Now, let's put that in perspective. The United States has a total resident population of about 324,227,000. Non-Hispanic whites constitute 63% of the U.S. population, with women accounting for about 50.8% of that demographic. Hispanics make up 17% of the U.S. population, blacks 12.3%, Asians 5%, and multiracial Americans at 2.4%. And yes, I realize that according to the National Rifle Association, between 2008 and 2015, the number of female instructors has climbed from just over 4,000 to more than 9,500. As laudable and nouveau Norman Rockwell as that may be, the truth is those 9,500 women have joined the ranks of 125,000 male NRA instructors. My graduate school statistics book was titled Lies, Damn Lies, and Statistics, which is to say, you can slice and dice those numbers in a lot of different ways. But one thing is inescapable. Women, minorities, and the disabled are still grossly underrepresented in the gun world, which brings me to the point. The winds of war are blowing across our country, and they're coming from many different directions. Unlike Mr. Roosevelt's war, there are more than two very disparate fronts, and most Americans are not prepared to protect themselves from ISIS, Black Lives Matter, or the psychotic whack job down the block who you've long suspected is burying people in his basement. Those threats notwithstanding, as formidable as they may be, pale compared to the threat posed by our own government. The fact is, precious few Americans are prepared to refresh the Tree of Liberty with the blood of patriots and tyrants. Well, the blood of tyrants, to be more specific. The blood of patriots will flow freely among the unprepared. The blood of tyrants, not so much, because they're armed to the teeth with M4s, MRAPs, body armor, and other military accoutrements. Seriously, you didn't know we were outgunned by the government? Perhaps you should stop watching The View and actually take a look at the view outside your living room window. Picture ain't pretty. Those that choose to not warm themselves with the blanket of protection we call the Second Amendment are most likely aiding and abetting the dissolution of the Second Amendment, either intentionally or through passive acceptance. In either case, it's naive to assume that once the powers that be have disarmed John Q., you lowly non-believers will fall to the same fate as everyone else. I mean, let's face it, John Q.'s only purpose would be to work to support those chosen few. And failure to do so will likely see you whisked off to U.S. government's version of that psychotic nutball neighbor's basement. At no time in history has it been more important to reach out to those groups, be they Republican or Democrat, male or female, white or persons of color, able-bodied or disabled, and assure them that everyone is welcome with open arms into our world. Everyone has a vested interest in the preservation of our way of life, and failure to successfully reach out will most likely see the winds of war sweep away our world forever. And that, Gretchen, is my rant for the week.
Well, I just learned how to handle my rifle this week, so.
You did? That's right.
I'm a little bit more ready than I was before. Now I just need to build a parapet on my roof.
That's true. You mean mofo. Wait, Mofet? Would that be Mofet? I'm not sure.
It's Mofet? Yeah, I think that's right.
I think you mean Mofet. That's it. You steered that AR pretty well.
I didn't do too badly.
Yeah, and I have to start watching what I say now.
You always did. Have to, I mean. Our guest in the studio tonight is Amy Dillon. Amy served 12 years on active duty in the United States Marine Corps. She's a former Marine Corps drill instructor and combat marksmanship instructor. She now works as a firearms instructor, Second Amendment advocate, and freelance writer, and competes in multiple shooting competitions nationwide. Welcome, Amy Dillon.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Excited to be here.
She actually belongs here. She should be here.
Well, yeah, I think so.
She's like one of us. Yeah, that's cool.
I am one of you guys.
Yeah. I thought the beginning of your rant was funny because I just had a text conversation with Marilyn about a half an hour ago. I said, you know, don't shoot Jim.
No. Well, you know, you don't want to shoot Jim. Jim's a good guy. It's interesting some of the things you're in. In particular, the one thing that I really would like to talk about is this DC project.
Yes.
That's a very interesting thing. Tell our listeners a little bit about DC Project.
Sure, I'd love to. It actually, listening to your rant tonight, it kind of echoes that same sentiment where a lot of stereotypes when it comes to who the owner of a gun is, always people think of the NRA type as being the white male. And with women especially being the fastest demographic of gun owners in the country, the DC Project kind of highlights who these gun owners actually are. It's not just what the public is used to thinking about for who owns guns in America. We're mothers, we're professionals, we are businesswomen. And, you know, one of the unique things about the DC Project is it's all women. It's a representative from every state who is in the firearms industry. And what we've done for the past 2 years is make trips to Washington, D.C., and we visited our legislative offices to establish relationships with our, you know, senators, our congressmen, and those offices, the actual lawmakers who, whenever they write these laws and pass these laws, they directly impact us, the gun owner. And I think it's important that they know who we are, they know our stories, and they know that, you know, how the laws that are coming to pass and what they're proposing, how it directly impacts the individual.
You're listening to On Target Radio. This is AM 560 The Answer. Give us a call at 312-642-5600. Our guest this evening is Amy Dillon, and we're talking about the DC Project. Specifically, and we got about a minute here before we go to break, but specifically, what sorts of things do you, do you just go to conservatives? Do you go to the anti-gun legislators?
Actually, we visited, the last trip we made was in July, and we visited Senator Feinstein's office, who, as you know, that name is very very parallel with the anti-gun.
did you wear body armor?
We did not. Oh. It was a very interesting discussion, though. I'd love to share, you know,
but
how that went.
You go in groups as well.
We
or
did.
Or you go one-on-one.
We did. And I had a very unique group because you were specifically talking about in your rant, you know, the stereotype. And we had a woman from New Jersey who happens to be African-American in the group that went in there. We also had a couple survivors of assaults sexual assault victims that came in and told their story about how being able to carry affected what happened to them. So it was very interesting. We had an immigrant who came here to the United States, and she talked about how gun control affected her country. Mm-hmm. So it was a very diverse group that went into these offices.
Do you just go once a year?
We made two trips this past year,
okay.
And we're planning our next big trip February of next year.
Excellent.
Well, I want to talk a little more about that when we come back. And we're going to be back with more On Target Radio. We got to take a break, have a few messages to pass on, and when we come back, we'll talk more with our guest, Amy Dillon, and we'll talk about the D.C. Project. You're listening to On Target Radio, and this is AM 560, The Answer.
Stuck in traffic? We've got the answer from the AM 560 Traffic Center.
Taking a look at traffic, the inbound.
That was perfect.
Dave,
we also had a...
Dave, I don't appreciate what you said about my guy Jim.
What about?
You said he was a good guy.
Well, he is a good guy.
I don't appreciate that at all.
Talking shit, Dave.
Yeah, we had a liberal.
He's like, he's talking about me. I was like, dude, he just
the Democrat
I try,
gun owners.
I try and stick up for
him. Oh, right, there's a Democrat gun owners club in California.
Yes. Okay.
I'm not taking back the ugly head.
I have a girl years who's very, very left wing.
Yeah.
But her thing, so she will never own a gun, actually. But her thing is she's never going to mess with my rights.
Right.
She doesn't want me messing with
her rights.
Who's that?
Plus, if something goes down, she wants to be able to call you.
But what is it that she does?
Huh?
What is it that
she's
does?
A liberal.
She's an anti-gun. Right?
And no. Well, I mean, she just would never own one herself.
Oh, well,
that's
which
all.
Is fine.
That's
fine.
But she just always says, like, I would never be considered anti-gun because I don't want to mess with your rights because I don't want you messing with mine.
Oh, she's saying that.
Right.
Oh, that's mm-hmm. kind of unusual.
Like a libertarian.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You
well,
know,
that's
the
cool.
So she gets upset when she hears people say, like, leftist
or
anti-gun.
Yeah, that's
you
good.
Know,
yeah.
Kind of
good
she doesn't, like,
it's, it should be a non.
To be fair, she doesn't have
court.
Yeah. We had parents, this was 2 years ago, we had parents bring their kid to our youth camp. This is our 18th year. And and they dropped the kid off like parents do, and I talking, and they were anti-gun. And I remember saying, explain to me. I'm happy to have your kid, but
they
I find it.
See the other view, or?
No.
Inside
said
education?
His friend's parents, father, had guns. And he was over at their house all the time. And they wanted him to know what was safe. They wanted to know how to be safe with a gun. And I said, I've never heard anybody anti-gun say something that smart about guns before.
Well,
yeah,
you're right.
Because usually they go, we don't have them, we don't touch it, we don't
yeah.
have children, do you have toy guns?
Yeah.
And I thought that was extremely practical.
It is.
Yeah.
Just from
I actually was reading like a Tribune from a month ago today, and in the, I don't know if you ever read the magazine part of it, the Tribune magazine
rarely,
part.
Yeah.
So there was an article in there about if your kids are going to other people's houses for play dates, ask if they have guns in their home and how they're stored. Yeah. And I was thinking, like, maybe we should have Mary Kalson on.
Yeah.
That's maxonshooters.com, Chicagoland's finest gun shop and indoor range. Don't miss this opportunity to meet John Lott at Max and Shooters, October 4th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m.
Check it out, it's the Terminator. Hey, when'd you get back, huh?
Did you have to shoot anyone?
Why are you so distant? Are you not happy to see me?
So what's the deal? You gonna get a job now or what?
Why are you being so jumpy? Put all that stuff behind you, okay?
No one knows what it's like to come back from Iraq or Afghanistan unless they were there. Join other veterans at communityofveterans.org because we know where you're coming from. Brought to you by Iraq and Afghanistan Veterans of America and the Ad Council.
You're listening to On Target Radio on AM 560, The Answer, with David Lombardo and Gretchen Fritz. Here's David and Gretchen with more interesting conversation on gun control, concealed carry, freedom of speech, and other red meat issues that affect your life.
This segment is brought to you by the Will County Grassroots Division of the Illinois State Rifle Association. Join like-minded friends supporting the right to keep and bear arms in Illinois at 7 p.m. on the third Wednesday of the month at the Silver Dollar Restaurant in Elwood, Illinois.
And we're back with More on Target Radio. And our guest this evening is Amy Dillon. And we're talking about the D.C. Project, which is one woman from every state that you get together once or twice a year and you go to Washington and you like drag them out, the anti-gun people drag them out and beat on them or something? How does that work?
No, they don't beat on us. Our focus is to bring awareness to the Second Amendment and also to provide education, especially when right now gun laws and just guns in general are such a highlighted, debated topic in our society. And that's due to a lot of, you know, different various things, violent shootings that have happened around the country, you know, the election year. So it's kind of interesting. You know, I bring up election year. One thing I want to say about the DC Project is it's nonpartisan. You know, it shouldn't be one way or the other side is going to be your Second Amendment supporter. And I think that's one of the other unique things that the DC Project brings. It's not just a bunch of one political party who's involved in the group. It's all political parties. And we actually have a very diverse group of women that are from different political, political platforms, I guess. So
and how does it, functionally, how does it work? You've got, I guess, 50 women
correct.
From each state. Is it like a bus outing? I mean, how do you actually make it all come together?
We are self-funded. Every single woman who's a part of the group has taken the time out of her, you know, busy life to ensure that she gets to D.C., meet up. We buy our own way. No one's supporting us. No one's sponsoring us. We're not looking for sponsors. It's really just about this is a, you know, personal effort because we realize the importance of it and we're all passionate about it. So it's not a sponsored, we're not on any sponsored agenda. We're purely here as a voice, as we are the, we are the voters. We're the voters, and this is how your laws that are being passed in D.C., in Washington, D.C., how this affects us.
Sure. Listen on Target Radio, is AM560 The Answer. Give us a call, 312-642-5600. It's interesting, did you actually talk to Senator Feinstein?
No, we didn't. The goal is to eventually talk to, and we did, I don't know off the top of my head which states, but we did actually talk to some congressmen, but a lot of the legislative offices, we were given access to their aides. And establishing relationships with the legislative aides are all, you know, that's also important because
sure.
They're the gatekeeper. Yeah. They're the ones that are telling the congressmen how to, the direction of how these laws come about.
And a lot of times the actual legislator themselves don't have time to read the
exactly.
bills. And so the aides actually brief them. They give them basically an executive summary
mm-hmm.
of what the bill says, and they tell them, okay, you know, you should probably vote this way based on, you know, these things. But, you know, I assume ultimately they make their own decision, but the aides are very
correct.
I was just going to say that there's a misconception about a lot of pro-Second Amendment people,
mm-hmm.
or on the part of a lot of pro-Second Amendment people. You hear them say all the time, you know, oh, those people in Washington, they're stupid, they don't know the facts. They know the facts.
Mm-hmm.
They clearly know what the facts are. And the Justice Department statistics, if they're skewed at all, this is the Obama administration. They're skewed. They're making them look good,
right.
as bad as they look. They're making them look better than you know they really are. But to think that these people are dumb and they don't know what they're doing, that's a mistake.
There's a lot of inexperience, I'll say, when it comes to actually handling firearms.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
And so, you know, like I know California just passed the bill, and I forget which one it was, but it's banning certain features.
Right.
You know, and one of the things that we found when speaking to some of the legislative offices were some of the legislative aides and some of the congressmen have never actually handled a firearm. So when it comes to them creating these laws that have restrictions on certain features of firearms, you wonder, well, how does that actually make us safer if that's the goal?
It doesn't. Yeah.
You know, and so one of the things that we did the last time we were there was we scheduled a range day, and we were inviting some of the offices out with us so that they could get their hands on firearms, they can see the recreational side of it, and know that it's purely, you know, about being educated when it comes to understanding when you have a set list in front of you on this is what we want to change. Well, do you even know what you're talking about? So
you
it's interesting.
It's true. And here's the interesting thing is I was an expert witness on Friedman versus Highland Park, which is an assault weapon ban. And the thing about that was the judge, when it went to the appellate court, the judge said, well, he admitted. He goes, well, okay, they don't use assault weapons in much, but if it makes the people of the community feel better, then it's okay. So the liberal concept is, if it makes you feel better, the Constitution's not that big of a deal. I mean, do you run head-on into that sort of a philosophy, or are they, like, polite and just smile and wait till you leave?
I don't know what happens after we leave. You know, but we've had, one of the things that we've done is establish a relationship. For example, we're not there just to have that one meeting and then, okay, thanks for listening, have a good day, we're out of here. This is our third time, some of the women there, our third time visiting the same offices. And now we're at the point where I know some of our representatives are on a, you know, they can call their offices directly and get a meeting to talk about issues. For example, you know, I can talk to my congressman, I can call his aide and say, hey, I know this bill's about to get reviewed. I'd like to have my input on it. Some of the women I know, one from Ohio, I believe it's North Carolina, they got word just this past week that their Congress offices have reached out to them to put them on the advisory committee for Second Amendment issues. So as far as making a difference and as far as being invited back to the office, is, you know, to talk about these issues, it's happening. And that was one of our goals, you know, for the DC project. And we're seeing that now. And I'm thinking that next year it's going to be even bigger.
Well, it's something that really needs to be done.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a pretty good lobbying staff here in Illinois. The Illinois State Rifle Association now has 5 lobbyists in Springfield. Todd Vandermeide is a lobbyist from the NRA. He's in Springfield.
Mm-hmm.
We're pretty well covered. But it sometimes shocks me when I watch committee meetings in Congress, how little some of those guys know.
That's right. And
they're making decisions.
Exactly. Yeah. They're making the decisions. And so I think it's important that just from a grassroots standpoint, that if you're regardless of the DC project or being involved in an organization that supports gun rights, I think that having your voice heard, it does make a difference. When you as a constituent go and you want to give a statement to, you know, whether it's your district representative or whether it's the senator, that stuff gets recorded, and it's important to have your voice heard and your opinion heard. And there's a strength in numbers. You know, so if everyone calls and says this is an important issue and this is what I want, you know, to be record that I feel this way strongly about the Second Amendment and these particular, whatever the topic or the issues are, I think it's important that people know how to do that. Committee hearings, I know in Charleston, South Carolina, we've got one coming up actually tomorrow, that there's a South Carolina Carry, which is a grassroots organization over there. They're looking for members to be able to attend the meetings. And I think it's important that if locally, you know, if they have the same, you hear about the same committee hearings happening in your town, I think it's important to show up and have your voice heard.
I think it's interesting because, you know, we teach concealed carry, you teach concealed carry in a different state, but it's very similar. And I think that there's a strong similarity between what we do in concealed carry and what you're talking about doing in Washington, D.C. as far as stamping out ignorance. You know, we joke that we're going to go stamp out ignorance this weekend. But it's so true. I mean, don't you get the exact same thing in class from students of these misconceptions that people have about guns?
Even people who
like guns, who they signed up for your class, so they're into guns at least that much.
Right.
But they still have so many misconceptions.
Mm-hmm. I hear that a lot in my classes. And, you know, talking about concealed carry permits, you know, it's an interesting thing because Illinois and South Carolina, we actually have some similarities that I thought you might be interested in hearing about.
Yeah,
and we're
going to
talk about
yeah.
that. We'll talk when we come back. I want to talk a little bit about national reciprocity, because I think it's a big deal. But we'll be back with more on Target Radio after a few messages, and you're listening to AM560, The Answer.
clock is ticking. The most important political event of the year comes to Chicago on October 29th. It's Freedom Summit 2016, featuring Lieutenant Colonel Alan West, Michelle Malkin, AM560's Mike Gallagher, Dan Proft, Amy Jacobson, and Joe Walsh. And just added, Dr. Sebastian Gorka, author of Defeating Jihad. Tickets start at just $39 and are available at freedomsummitchicago.com. That's
okay, there's a town called West Chicago.
Oh, it's not the city.
Not
that's already true.
Chicago's
not
Chicago.
Oh, okay.
West
Chicago.
It's West Chicago.
You're right by there.
Yeah. West Chicago.
So, I don't know, but here's a question. Yeah. Do they have a gun store region in West Chicago?
There is. There is. Doesn't really have a storefront, but he does custom stuff. He does FFL transfers. I've been to it.
So what, they're going to shut him down if this passes?
So they're just not allowed to have gun stores there? Is that what they're trying to do?
Yeah, there's,
well,
I'm sure
I don't know
any
specifics, but they're having, their planning and zoning commission is having a meeting on Tuesday.
Yeah, I'm sure there's.
And that's something that they're going
to
be discussing.
And then that open to the public?
Yeah, we're encouraging people to go and make their opinion.
There's a book signing.
So very similar, but on Tuesday.
She said she's got it all at Maxson's and displays. But she's got it all in her action items, man, so she's on the ball.
He's not coming up just for book signing. Was he got something else going on?
It took me over an hour to write my action.
Well, you know what? It's the elections coming up, so it's
maybe.
I don't know, maybe crunch time.
I don't know.
Somebody from some woman who has some sort of an organization at Maxson's.
There's only the well-armed woman in
there. That must be it. So heard me speak someplace, I don't remember where, and came up to me and said, oh, we'd like to have you speak at Max's. And I go, okay, I'd be happy to do that. Then I get an email from her and says, but you can't mention Safer USA.
Why?
And I go,
they asked me to speak about Nicola Lace.
I go, see, everything that I've talked about at the meeting where you heard me is because I have Safer USA. How can I extract that? How can I not talk about it?
Right, it's integral to what you are.
Right. I mean, I don't have to pitch courses per se and try and get
customers. See, the women who started that group actually left and are now down at the range of 355, and now it's a different person. That's
how long ago was that?
Like a couple months ago, beginning of the
Well, this was about, was it when I went to, the ISRA chapter in...
Oh, Midlothian?
Oh, so she was supposed to talk there tomorrow night, and that because the other women were going to set it up, and then she's like, no, I already have someone. It's like, you realize she's coming in from South Carolina, so the person you have from down the street can do this, like, next month? And she was like, no, I already set someone up, so I'm not going to do that. So whoever she is a little...
Yeah.
I just wouldn't even worry about it.
I see. Well, she said, we don't want you taking business away from Max. I don't have to talk about sign up for my course, but everything we do is predicated on the fact that we have this school.
Right.
And, I mean, how are you going to, I wouldn't be an expert witness if I hadn't taught 7,000 students.
Right.
How can I ignore that? Yeah.
So we have certain listeners who private message us instead of posting stuff on our wall.
Okay.
one of them said, great guest tonight.
Oh, great.
A lot of them watch on YouTube. That's
do you get questions? Like, are you getting questions throughout when we're talking?
We sometimes do. Yeah. We haven't yet, but we sometimes do.
Is there any point in here where you want to weigh in?
Oh, I just asked a question, but I will.
Yeah, you
end.
Should.
Yeah.
To non-resident permits. Find out what over 6,000 students already know at saferusa.com
or call 815-741-3474. That's 815-741-3474. Safer USA. Choosing to own a firearm is your business. Teaching you to own it responsibly is ours.
Experience the Joffrey Ballet's triumphant return of Christoph Pastor's Romeo and Juliet. A critically acclaimed reimagining of Shakespeare's star-crossed lovers set to Sergei Prokofiev's epic score. A masterful achievement on every level, says the Chicago Sun-Times. October 13th through the 23rd at the Auditorium Theater. Call 312-386-8905 or visit joffrey.org.
Welcome to Move Time Radio, presented by the Arthritis Foundation. And we're smack dab in the middle of our dance-a-thon to fight arthritis pain. Me, I've been grooving for 10 hours straight, baby, but I'm a boogie machine. See, movement is just one of the ways to help fight osteoarthritis pain. Another is weight loss. You get rid of just 1 pound. That's 4 pounds of pressure off each knee. For more information on managing pain, visit fightarthritispain.org. Then meet me on the dance floor. This message brought to you by the Arthritis Foundation and the Ad Council.
You're listening to On Target Radio on AM560, The Answer, with David Lombardo and Gretchen Fritz. Here's David and Gretchen with more interesting conversation on gun control, concealed carry, freedom of speech, and other red meat issues that affect your life.
October is Glocktober at Schrank Smoke and Gun. For every Glock firearm purchased, you receive 3 free gifts, including a Glock 4 pistol range bag, a Glock bench map, and a box of range ammo. What a deal. Schrank's has dozens of Glock models in stock, from the Glock 42 and 380 ACP to the Glock 20 in 10mm. And with the largest selection of new, used, and consignment firearms in Lake County, you'll avoid the Cook County firearm and ammo tax with just a short drive north. For gunsmithing, you know you can count on family-owned Schrank's for over 52 years. Be sure to take advantage of Schrank's special Glocktober sale by purchasing a Glock and receiving your free gifts. Cigar lovers, and I am, be sure to stock from Schrank's humidors. Visit smoke-the-letter-and-gun.org or call 847-662-4034. Schrank's Smoke and Gun in Waukegan, your family-owned gun store since 1964. That's 847-662-4034. Online at smoke-the-letter-and-gun.org.
10mm.
There you go. Size counts.
They let me shoot it. It was really cool.
Size matters.
Size matters.
Size matters. Okay, well, we lost control of the show. So anyway, I'm sorry. Our guest this evening is Amy Dillon, and we've been talking about the D.C. project, but we want to talk a little bit about, since you're in Washington and you talk to people, and I guess you get kind of a feel for the pulse of it, national reciprocity. This is something that... It floated a lot years ago, mm-hmm. but because there were 2 states, Illinois and Wisconsin, that weren't, they kept saying that was the excuse. Now there's no excuse. What have you heard? Anyone?
I know in most states there's talk about this national reciprocity bill. And basically what it is where it comes to, when it comes to the concealed weapon permits or concealed carry licenses, whatever, you know, every state says it's something different, but... treating it like a driver's license, where every state can regulate the permit requirements, but also have to recognize other states' permits. And you probably hear this in your classes too, but one of the things that I always hear from students is, why can't there be some type of federal carry permit? And I always, sure. I always say, well, you know, with a federal carry permit, one of the dangers of having that would be that who would be in charge of it?
The federal government.
And if the federal government...
Exactly.
So we don't want the federal government getting involved, even though you do have some states that are a lot more strict, some states that are a lot, less or more lenient. One of the examples that I give when it comes to how this can kind of go, either way, the state of California... Did you guys see that the Ninth Circuit Court just passed that the Second Amendment does not apply to the general public in regards to being able to carry concealed weapons? And there was a...
What they said, they didn't say it doesn't apply. They said it doesn't guarantee
that
you have the right. So mm-hmm. they've left it up to the... They upheld California.
Yeah, right. And I think there was a group that tried to push it up to the U.S. Supreme Court. And the U.S. Supreme Court said, no, we're going to allow the state Supreme Court to... Yeah. We're going to stand by their decision. And I think I wasn't against it at first, but then I thought, well, maybe this is a good decision, because if every state can still regulate their own, in regards to how a person can obtain a concealed weapon permit, then it doesn't make it to where the U.S. Supreme Court or the federal government has the power to govern how all states should regulate the permit, right?
But here's my thought.
Okay.
My thought on that is this. We don't do that with free speech.
That's
true. We don't
true.
Do that with quartering troops.
That's true.
We don't do that with the equal clause. Why? It's the Bill of Rights. It's not the Bill of the country's rights. It's the Bill of the Rights of the people. Why is the Second Amendment accepted and the other nine are not? I'm not. That's a rhetorical
right,
question.
Right. No. Right.
But you see what I'm saying?
That's the question.
And anyone who's a purist on the Second Amendment would make the argument: you have no right to do this. It's in the Bill of Rights.
Mm-hmm.
Hillary Clinton seems to think that it's antiquated and we shouldn't have the. Actually,
there's a lot.
That the
there's
Constitution
a lot, yeah.
is antiquated.
Well, yeah. There's a number of people who feel that way.
Yeah.
But and then there's the 10th Amendment, which is basically what you're talking
exactly.
about, Amy, which
yeah.
is right. which is you know the rights that are not. You know, given to
otherwise
the federal
covered.
Government
yeah.
are reserved to the states or to the people,
yeah.
Respectively. So, you know, I think that, you know, marriage is a states' rights issue,
right.
big-time states' rights issue, and, you know, there's, it's vague.
It's very
it's
vague.
It's one of those gray, squishy areas of some go to states' rights and some go to the federal government.
Mm-hmm.
And but I tend to agree with what you're saying, is it's better if the states have
right.
more control rather than the federal government, because the more centralized it is, the less power we have.
Exactly.
It takes a lot of power away from the people. And if the states have the rights, then you can pick a state that
goes
that
along with how
to you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, with the National Reciprocity Bill, what that would allow is every state still has the power to regulate their own, you know, permit laws, but it's still recognized by every state.
Yeah, and I got something I want to say about that, but we have to go to a commercial break, and we will be back. And when we come back, I do want to make a comment about that. Todd Vandermeid made a really interesting case in the legislature a couple of weeks ago. But we'll be back with more on Target Radio, and you're listening to AM 560, The Answer.
Stuck in traffic? We've got the answer from the AM 560 Traffic Center.
Taking a look at traffic in McHenry of an accident involving a pedestrian. Multiple injury crews are reporting there. That's at Riverside Drive and Pearl Street, 1400 block of Riverside in McHenry. Board that area if you can. Out in Darien, an accident on Cass south of Plainfield Road. And northbound 65 remains jammed 49th up to 8094 in Indiana. And a vehicle fire closing that ramp to 8094. They're doing some cleanup there. No delays elsewhere. Edens and Kennedy looking good. The express lanes are closed. Overnight road work. Ike Stevenson, your Southside Expressways, Lakeshore Drive, and the tollways all moving okay. No delays on 53 and I-80 to and from Joliet. 63 degrees in Chicago, some patchy fog after 3, a low of 58. Tomorrow, fog turning to partly sunny skies, a high of 68. Next update in 15 minutes on AM 560, The Answer.
For over 100 years, the Illinois State Rifle Association has supported the rights and freedoms of Illinois citizens to keep and bear arms. For over one...
Not long ago.
Got it, 3412.
So I want to make that point. But,
okay.
And then we'll talk about open versus concealed carry, because I'm sure we'll have an interesting discussion on that subject. But, yeah.
Open carry?
The whole thing is, though... It is in the Bill of Rights. What right do they have to say?
What to say otherwise?
Can't do that. Right. And they love to drag out, well, you can't yell fire in a theater. Okay, so you can't yell gun in a theater. I'll go for that. So what? You know, it's just.
Yeah, and that's my whole point behind it. Inciting a, what is it? Inciting a, not a riot, but when you yell fire in a theater,
yeah,
you are inciting
right. whatever. Yeah.
And
the free, you know, the Freedom thing in Highland Park was just infuriating.
Nothing has
I did a video
Nobody
for
knows.
It.
You know
and
I mean?
we showed
I tell people
every item on that list.
When you start to
we highlighted, explained it, showed guns firing, showed different guns firing, did the whole thing. Laid it out. In fact,
no
it's referred to in the Supreme Court. They don't list my name,
no
but they refer to the video I did.
I'm like, just check yourself in the mirror before
and the appellate court judge just said,
thank
he said,
and, like
I recognize that assault weapons don't really cause a problem. But if it makes the people happy, that's good enough.
Safer.
Yes. It trumps your constitutional right. And they went, you know, on a cert of the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court took the pass.
Yes, we had to talk about that. She's a big feet like me. She's taller. Yeah, she's still excited a lot.
What are we doing? Okay, yeah.
Where are we at?
We're coming back.
I'm so sorry.
What's your state forester and the ad council. Learn more at SmokeyBear.com.
Oh,
prevent wildfires.
You're listening to On Target Radio on AM 560, The Answer, with David Lombardo and Gretchen Fritz. Here's David and Gretchen with more interesting conversation on gun control, concealed carry, freedom of speech, and other red meat issues that affect your life.
And we're back with more On Target Radio. Give us a call, 312-642-5600. Phones have lit up and gone off. I don't know. They get on and they don't like us and they hang up. I'm not sure what's going on.
They're scared.
Before we went to break, we were talking a little bit about the National Reciprocity Law. And I wanted to point out that Todd Vandermeid, who's the NRA legislative guy here in the state of Illinois, made a really good point. They are trying to rescind the part of the concealed carry law that said what would they call assault weapons fall under that law, and there can be no new ones. And what they're trying to do is do away with that and allow to go community by community. But the issue is, and this is what Todd said, it's a good point. Can you imagine if every community in the state of Illinois had their own law that governed long guns? You drive up I-55 from Missouri up to Chicago and go through, how many counties are there? 200 and some counties in the state? So
no, there's just over 100.
Okay, over 100. So you'd go through probably 50 counties making that drive.
So you'd have to pull over, look up each law in every different county to make sure you're complying.
Right. That'd be crazy.
It is crazy.
And the other issue is this. We know, Florida has had it since 1987. Concealed carry permit holders don't cause trouble. I mean, it really is that simple. They don't.
Yes. Statistically, it's not significant.
Right. And naturally, we get blamed for everything.
And then you have some states that give constitutional carry, where there's even a permit system. So
there have been a few states lately that have gone to that.
That's right. Yeah. I think the last one was it Missouri?
That sounds,
I think it was. They just
passed it. I think there's eight states now.
I think Oregon recently did, too. I want to say it was.
Was it?
It was one out west. Maybe it wasn't Oregon. Maybe it was
Oregon's kind of hippie.
That's true. There's a lot of granola eaters out there.
If they pass that law, it's because everybody in the legislature was doing a doobie and they weren't paying attention. You know what I'm saying?
Whoa, man, what just happened?
Yeah, it's cool. What?
Constitutional carry. We have Idaho, Wyoming, Arizona,
Idaho.
Alaska, Kansas, Mississippi, West Virginia, Vermont, and Maine.
Now, and here's the interesting thing. Vermont is a good example. Mm-hmm. It's constitutional carry. As long as you're not a felon, you can walk into a store, buy a gun, buy a holster, put it on, walk out. Now, there, by percentage, number of people who own lawfully and carry concealed who then use a gun in a crime rate is no different than Illinois, where we have all these laws and 16 hours of training or whatever. Florida, since 1987, has done about 3 million, and their rate of somebody who commits a crime with a gun is 0.006%. It's better than police.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, more police commit crimes with guns than concealed carry.
Concealed permit holders.
And so this it's nonsense when they come up with this stuff.
Wow.
Yeah, and I say in class all the time, you know, so far we've only had concealed carry for a couple of years here, but so far, you know, it seems to me that people who have concealed carry rise to the occasion.
Yeah.
I don't know how, but they just do.
Especially when you look at some of the people. Never mind. Okay. but you're right. You're absolutely right.
I wasn't going to go there.
I know. I just decided I better stop or we'll never get anybody in class.
Now, one of the things I notice is, because you mentioned Illinois being the concealed carry is kind of new.
Right.
What I found out as a South Carolina resident is I'm actually eligible to apply for the Illinois concealed carry license.
One of four states.
Yeah. And South Carolina is grouped into the category with Virginia, Hawaii, and New Mexico.
Yep.
And I always wondered, you know, how did they come up with that random? It seems so random, that list of states.
What the law says is a state that has concealed carry laws similar to the state of Illinois.
I don't know if it's the law, but the rules that the state police set up, they said that they decided that the law had to be substantially similar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And those are the states that, now I thought New Mexico was a little bit more,
I thought they were a little bit more open with their
I've seen video of their test. Their test is actually the shooting test is a lot harder than ours. Our shooting test is a cakewalk.
Wow.
It's not really substantially similar.
Do you want to actually know what happened? I happen to know how it really happened.
I would like to know what happened.
Here's what happened. Trey Gowdy called Lisa Madigan, who is the daughter of Michael Madigan, and said, I understand that your father's been up to some stuff. Let's do the reciprocity with my state, or we're going to investigate Mike Madigan. And that sealed it right there.
Huh, that worked out. I know. I thought it was because South Carolina, compared to the other states in the South, we are one of we're the only state that has no type of open carry allowance. And I know you guys don't either, right?
No.
Illinois doesn't. So I thought maybe that might be...
How many hours of training does South Carolina require?
We don't have any. We don't have any stand or set
any
hours.
Specific?
You know,
okay.
there's no limit. It used to be an 8-hour time limit, but we now say that as long as the mandated topics were covered, and the instructor can sign off that the student received the training and they can prove that, because there's a test and there's a
so
training
qualification. So they do have to take a class, but
they
it's not any specific length of time.
Correct.
That's how Utah is too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I saw that list, Hawaii, did you know, and I read this, I haven't fact-checked this, but I read it in a reliable source, and it said that there's only one person in the state of Hawaii that has concealed carry. Did you read this?
I read that, and it was the guy who administered
the program. The guy who gives
concealed
carry.
There's no known record of anyone else in Hawaii.
My theory is that he only did it so he could test the computer system.
Oh yeah, there you go.
I think the reason
is he actually carrying.
I think the reason he did it is because he's afraid everybody else is going to try and shoot him, and he wants to be armed. Because as we know from Chicago. Legal possession of a firearm isn't that popular in certain parts of the city, but there's a lot of guns there. Anyway, we're going to come back. We're going to wrap the whole thing up. Gretchen's got her action items, and we're going to give Amy a chance to tell you how to get a hold of her if you want to.
And we're going
to
do segment six.
And we're going to do segment six. That's correct. We'll talk about that, too. So we'll be back after these messages with more On Target Radio, and you're listening to AM 560,
The Answer.
If you're looking for a better shooting experience, imagine shooting virtually all your firearms the same day. You can move and shoot steel, draw from the holster, or compete in a three-gun match. You can exercise that rifle up to 600 yards, even engage in a very challenging sporting clays course, or a round of trap or skeet. Do all that and much more at the Aurora Sportsman's Club. Whether you're a novice looking for a basic course or an experienced shooter looking for an advanced course, even if you want to participate in your favorite shooting event such as IDPA or cowboy action shooting. Spend an enjoyable day with the family at the Aurora Sportsman's Club, the only shooting facility in the region that offers all of that and more. If that sounds interesting, don't miss the next orientation and a tour of the Aurora Sportsman's Club in Waterman, Illinois. Call the membership department at 815-264-9000 extension 44 for information. That's 815-264-9000 extension 44 to join a one-of-a-kind shooting.
But,
it's my mom.
Okay.
My mom. I don't want to get in trouble.
That's right.
Yeah, no, that'd be a mistake.
I love your mom.
My mom is obsessed with listening to what we say during the commercials. So we have to turn on.
I used to do my mom on the show.
Yeah, so that she can hear what we're saying.
So when I was walking around Waikiki at the shopping strip,
the home of the $100
hamburger, like these little Asian girls on the poster, like a little girl holding her rifle and stuff, because they're trying to get those people that are there, right? They're trying to draw them in to go and you don't have to own a gun. You don't have to come in for hours because they don't think
that. Representative, and set up a time to come meet with us at our home. You can't put a price on peace of mind, but if you had to, all it takes is one visit. Call 847-593-2000. 847-593-2000. Or start your visit through our open doors at tastycatering.com.
You're listening to On Target Radio on AM 560, The Answer, with David Lombardo and Gretchen Fritz. Here's David and Gretchen with more interesting conversation on gun control, concealed carry, freedom of speech, and other red meat issues that affect your life.
And we're back with On Target Radio. Our guest this evening has been Amy Dillon. Amy, if people want to get a hold of you to talk about some of these issues, how can they do that?
They can reach out to me on any of my social media accounts. Facebook's probably the best platform to reach me at. I'm Amy Dillon, AMYDILLON. And they can also find out more information on the DC Project and find out who their state representative is on the DC Project Facebook page as well.
Who is a state representative here?
It's Lori
Lori Blackwell.
Okay.
And she's with the well-armed woman.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And stick around, Jim. We're going
to
be doing
segment six. Yep. Make sure to head over to our YouTube channel right after the show.
So we'll be doing segment six, and we'll be talking more about you. And now we're going to have Gretchen weigh in.
Stand by. Here's Gretchen with your action items for the week.
On Tuesday, October 4th, the West Chicago Zoning Commission will consider a measure that would effectively ban the operation of a firearm retail store or range anywhere in the village. If you live in or near West Chicago, please attend the West Chicago Zoning Board of Appeals and Planning Commission meeting to be held 7 p.m. Tuesday, October 4th, in the Council Chambers of West Chicago City Hall. City Hall is located at 475 Main Street in West Chicago. We recommend that you get there by 6:30 p.m. to ensure that you get a seat. Be prepared to vigorously defend your right to keep and bear arms. You may have the opportunity to address the Zoning Commission, so know your facts about your nation's heritage of safe, lawful, and responsible firearms ownership. If you see members of the media at the meeting, approach them and tell them you are a law-abiding firearm owner who is sick and tired of baseless attempts to curtail your rights. Concerned about your gun rights? You should be. Join other concerned citizens at a special event on Wednesday, October 5th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. at the Heartland Institute with special guest Dr. John Lott Jr. In his latest book, The War on Guns, Lott offers the most thorough debunking yet of the so-called facts, data, and arguments of anti-gun advocates, exposing how they have repeatedly twisted or ignored the real evidence that refutes their every point. There is no cost for the dinner and speaker, but donations are appreciated. The Heartland Institute, Andrew Breitbart Freedom Center, is located at 3939 North Wilkie Road in Arlington Heights, Illinois. To register, go to heartland.org and click on events or use the link on our Facebook page. The following Safer USA classes are at our facility in Waterman, Saturday and Sunday, October 8th and 9th, and October 22nd and 23rd. Illinois Concealed Carry 1. This 16-hour class will be taught by David and Gretchen and meets the training requirements for Illinois Concealed Carry as well as Florida, Arizona, and Utah. Sunday, October 16th, Long Range Rifle, taught by Ed Janka. To sign up for classes, go to saferusa.com and click on register.
It's another good show.
Yeah, action-packed.
Yeah, it's a good show. And, it was a good class I had today. I think it's been going reasonably well. My good friend, John Reed, the attorney, made a sizable contribution to keeping the show up for...
Oh, good.
You know, yeah. It's,
that's good news.
And I found a certain amount of irony that John gave us a big contribution, and he's a bankruptcy attorney. I didn't know if there was a message hidden in there or something, you know, like, you know.
That's beyond ironic, I think.
That's what I thought. I go, John, are you telling me something? I don't know.
He wants to get your business on the other end, too.
Yeah, he does. That's what he said. I want your business. Here's your check back. But we do. We thank John Reed and Joliet, his bankruptcy attorney. If you're having a bad time, call John. And we'd like to thank Amy Dillon for coming in tonight and for you taking the time to listen to On Target Radio. Be sure to tune in next week when we'll cover more red meat issues that affect your life.
We'd also like to thank George Hoffman on the board, Jim Extrand, our video producer, and our sponsors, the Will County Grassroots Division of the ISRA, Schrank Smoking Gun, the Illinois State Rifle Association, the Aurora Sportsman's Club, and Safer USA.
And be sure to stay tuned for segment six with Amy and Marilyn Smolensky will be on that show also. So we'll be talking about that. See you then. And thanks, Mike.